Giving honor again to the man Christ Jesus, the presence of God in our midst. Good afternoon to the house of faith. Today, there is a song I want us to start, a hymn I want us to stand and sing. If you have the ready hymn now, it's number 399. How many persons have the hymn now? Anyway, it's a hymn that we all know, right? So, if you care, if you don't know the words, just hum, right? Or as old people say, la la, and we go move mountains here.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Faith of a
I'm
Church. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, church. And the Word was God, and the same Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us. And he said, I come to my own, and my own received me not. But as many as received me, he had given them the power to be called the sons of God. O Son of God, whose love so free, God made thee, God did make thee man to be. United to our God in thee, may we be one. No, this is my first time in St. John's Spiritual Baptist Church. And today I am impressed, church. I am impressed. Because he tells me that, you know, where two and three are gathered, he's in the midst and he's to be blessed. And today, church, as I stated earlier, we are not here for form or fashion. We are here for serious business. And today, church, when I look around and I see the administration, church, you know, wisdom in the house. And understanding finishing. And he said, the wise man build his house on top of a rock. But the foolish man build his house on the sand. But the one that build his house on the rock, the foundation will stand. When the trying time comes, they're going to see the presence of God is in this place. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, I will hear them from heaven. I will forgive the sin and I will heal the land, church. Today, wisdom build a house and understanding finish it. And today, church, I praise God for Reverend Mike and his congregation. I pray that God will take you from strength to strength. I pray that in your going out and in your coming in, that you will be blessed. I pray that in every endeavor you will be the head and not the tail. I pray that the power of God will rest upon you. I pray that the authority of God will anoint you. God lift you up, and as you are lifted up, may you be an agent of transformation and change within the community. For when we are elevating, church, we are to elevate others. Today, church, righteousness exalts the nation. I'm not preaching on the foundation yet. I'm admonishing. Righteousness exalts a nation. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach unto any man. Today, the people of St. John's Spiritual Baptist Church walk in the vocation for which you are called. Lead as God wants you to lead. Teach what God wanted to teach. Feed the people the word of God and the directions of the Spirit of God. For God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Today I am happy to be in this place. I wish I could come many more times. Because, you know, the saint, our ancestors used to say, bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And today, church, we are one people. Today, as we are here, yes, we are from Mount Rahab and we are from St. John, but we are first the people of God. And today, you know, let us be one. Let us pray for one another. Let us admonish one another. If you're walking down the road and you see a brother falling by the wayside, don't condemn your brother, but just trying to lift up the brother, trying to elevate the sister. Because you see, when you have positive thinking people in your surroundings, when you have spiritually minded people in your surroundings, church, you too will be spiritually minded. You too will think positively. Because as iron sharpened iron, as iron sharpened iron, now so too those that are around us is able to sharpen us and keep us in check. And if we're not careful, they can lead us in the wrong path. Today, I was given a foundation to deliver it all. And when you're building a foundation, church, you have to build a firm foundation. Because every structure that will arise will stem from the foundation. And even if the whole building falls, the foundation must be able to stand. So the foundation message should be a very powerful message. And I have no strength, no power, and no authority of my own. But I am here according to the authority given to me by God to proclaim liberty to the captive, to set free those that are in bonds, to heal the brokenhearted, and to point them to salvation. Today, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The Corinthians was one of the sets of people that were privileged to be some of the they were a category of people that were fortunate to have the word of God declared to them by the apostles of God. Because the people that declared the word of God to them, most of them heard the word of God firsthand from Christ.
You know,
heavens, which also ye received, and wherein ye stand. Where are you standing today? On what foundation are you standing? On what precepts are you standing? On what ordinance are you standing? And whose word are you standing? According to whose instruction are you walking? In what path have you been walking? Are you walking in the vocation that you are called? Are you walking in accordance to the instruction of the Spirit of God? Are you standing based on the authority given to you by God? Or are you standing on another foundation that is not of God? Be not deceived by people. All good gifts coming from God, who is the Father of lights. So, the gospel, the good news, gospel means good news. So anyone ask you what the word gospel means, tell them it means good news. The gospel is the good news. Today, and you know, we must all be proud of the gospel. We must all be proud of the good news. And the gospel was to say, by which also ye are saved. Salvation means to save. As a matter of fact, salvation comes from the root word, which means salvage, which means to save. So when you're trying to salvage something, you are trying to save it. So the word of God, the gospel of God, is able to salvage us. It's able to save us from Satan's dark dominion and from the chains of darkness, from the chains of destruction and the fetters that keeping us back. The gospel of God is able to save us from them. If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. You see, when Paul said the gospel is able to save the Corinthians, and by extension us, Paul made a conditional statement. And if you're not familiar with what a conditional statement is, a conditional statement is one that depends upon another statement or another instruction, some other thing. There is a condition attached to it. There is, you know, there is something that comes with it. It's a package. So you cannot expect to be saved and not do what you are supposed to do. You cannot expect the Spirit of God to work for you if you're not taking instruction of the Spirit of God. You cannot expect the Spirit of God to help you to prosper unless you are willing to do the work that the Spirit has appointed you to do. God will only bless you with the material prosperity that you're asking for when you are willing to do the spiritual work that He has sent you to do. Today, we live a life and you know we are caught between opposing forces. And sometimes we are one-sided. You know, as spiritual people, we have to understand the mystery of the scale, church. You have to be balanced. You see, you cannot expect to feed the carnal and the spiritually starving. You cannot expect to walk in the realm of mortality and not experience realms of immortality. You got to drop down the mortal and pick up immortality. You got to drop down the physical and start walking in the realms of the spirit and say, according to thy gracious word, and make humility. This will I do by thy Lord. I will remember thee. So you could go in the store and buy all your nice clothes and you know your costly apparel. You know, and you could buy all the makeup to make your face look nice. You know, and to shine your appearance before men. You know that men may see your beauty and say, wow. No, I've seen the glory of God, or I've seen an angel. But you know what about your appearance before the throne of God? What about your looks before the throne of God? You know, sin is a reproach unto all men. And today, we have to careful the things that we elevate in our lives, because we are a spiritual people with a carnal experience. I'm not sure I'm ashamed of that. A lot of people don't like to accept it. But you see, when you're working for spirit, when you're working for spirit, you have to understand that we have to walk with the spirit. You cannot be walking with the spirit and still condemning the spirit at the same time. You see, we have to understand the order we are in. And today, before we became mortals, we were first spiritual beings. And we have been given a charge to keep. And sometimes when we come in this world, you know, when we come in this world, we get caught up with the cares of this world, you know, the material things. And we forget the condition. Remember verse 2 talk about, you know, the gospel saving us. If you receive the word, or unless you believe in vain, the word of God will not save you. You see, you have to have faith as a mustard seed. And just so when we came into this realm of mortality, we were given a condition upon which to prosper. We came into a system, church, where there was already a framework. There was a foundation, a pathway ordained for us to walk. That was the vocation that we are called. And before you came, all your ancestors walked that way. It's a covenant. It's an ancient covenant. When you come in the church, you see different emblems. Yeah. It was there long before even your blueprint was born. And today, a lot of us are trying to do away with it. But if you are in the blessing of God, you have to continue. You see, when your parents and your foreparents start a foundation, you have to take it and turn it into a legacy. And when you do that, you will be blessed. Let no one fool you. Let no one deceive you. Walk in the vocation wherein you are called. Verse 3 said, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. I cannot preach to you something and I don't believe in myself. Or I don't know myself. Otherwise, it would be like the blind leading the blind. You see, Paul was speaking to the people and he was telling them of things that he had received for himself. So then the question may be asked, you know, those persons that say, do as I say and not as I do, did they really receive the word? Because you see, we must not only be hearers of the word, but we have to be doers. Doers of the word. You know, action. You have to take action. You know, when you hear the word of God, you have to go home and meditate on it. You know, and find yourself in your secret chamber and commune with the Spirit of God. So that the Spirit of God will be able to direct you, you know, as to how to digest the food. No, because I'm giving you all the food here. And when you go home, you have have to ask God to help you to digest that food. Help you to, you know, figure out, you know, show you how to use the message. To work in the realms of privilege and authority. So Paul declared, delivered unto them a gospel that he received for himself. So when you are a preacher of the word of God, you have to be a doer of the word of God. When you are a declarer of the word of God, you must first declare the word to yourself. You have to first teach yourself so you can teach others. You have to be convicted within yourself before you can convince others. You have to, you know, you have to believe in the power of the message. You know, it's like going in front of a podium and delivering a speech on a topic that you yourself do not believe in. Who you fooling? Fooling yourself. Today, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. So Paul is having to give them some history here. Christ died for your sins. Because a lot, you know, the message was preached to them so many times, and a lot of them still considered it foolishness. Especially the Greeks. They considered the fact that a man died on the cross for your sins foolishness. And even to this day, church, a lot of persons consider the fact that a man gave his life on the cross on Mount Calvary for your sin and for my sin, they consider it foolishness. But the Bible said, Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was seen, you know, he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12 disciples. Cephas was the high priest. And that he was seen of about 5,000 persons at once. I was in Galilee, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some have fallen asleep. I want to explain that here. You know, we're reading this Bible and we have to remember it was transcribed from scrolls. So when the Bible said here, the greater part remain unto the present. Present tense is not. But it doesn't mean like in 2021. It was when the record was taken. When the record was made in the scrolls. You see, because back then, they wrote holy scriptures and scrolls and stones and tables of stones and so forth. You know, that's how the word of God was represented. But today we use trees and we make paper and so forth. But the word of God was written in scrolls. So at the time when the word of God was written on the scrolls, many of the multitude that saw Christ before he ascended to heaven was still alive. When Paul was speaking to the Corinthians, many of them were still alive. After that, he was seen of James. I just go back to verse 6 and it says, some have fallen asleep, and then some have died. Alright? And verse 7 said, after that, he was seen of James, then of the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. Paul knew he had a purpose. Paul knew that the time he born is the time he was supposed to born. The time Paul born was the time Paul supposed to born. When Paul's parents gave birth to him, it was the time they were supposed to give birth to him, not before, not after. And he was born in due time. For I am the least of the apostles. What do Paul mean by that? You see, there were 12 disciples. And one of the 12 betrayed Christ. That was Judas. And when Judas realized the sin he had committed, he went and he hung himself on a tree. So one of the disciples died. And when the apostles were ordained, it was the disciples that were ordained as apostles, church. So you see, there were supposed to be 12 apostles, but since one committed suicide, there was now 11 apostles. So they needed one more. So when Christ ascended, the apostles came together and they anointed a man, or they named a man by the name of Matthias, the prophet, not the prophet, but the apostle, in the place of Judas. But you see, Matthias was an apostle according to the ordinance of man. But you see, although they lifted up Matthias, Christ came and he lifted up Paul. So that's why Paul said he's the least of the apostles. Because he was an apostle, not by man, but he was an apostle by God. You see, God had ordained him to be an apostle. And before he became an apostle, church, his life was not the best of life. You know, his words were not the best of words. But his way of living was not in line with the word of God. You see, you can be living whatever reckless life you're living. When God is ready to call you from this realm and bring you into that realm and in that office, when God wants to elevate the church, you know, he doesn't look at the outward appearance, because man looks at the outward appearance and God looks at the heart. You know, because before Paul was created, notice I say Paul was created, because Paul was not born. In the sense that when his mother and his father gave birth to him, they didn't call him Paul. They didn't give birth to a child named Paul. They didn't dedicate a child named Paul, but they dedicated a child named Saul. And Saul was the one that standing on the side and watching as they crucified Christ. You know, and Saul was the one that going around persecuting the church of Christ. And in persecuting the church of Christ, he was persecuting Christ himself, because Christ said, as much as you have done it to the least of my brothers, you have done it unto me. Church, Saul's life was not the best of life. Saul's code of conduct was not in accordance to what man perceived that a Christ-like person should be like. You know, and sometimes we look at certain people, we look at the way that they dress. No, we're talking common man language, no. We look at the way that they dress. We look at the shoes in their feet. We look at the condition of the clothes. No, and we look at the tattered clothes with stain. And we look at, you know, their facial appearance. And we say there could be nothing good in that man. Or there could be nothing good in that woman. But you see, God has chosen the basis of things to confirm those that are mighty. God has chosen the least to confirm the greatest. God has chosen the small to confirm those that think they're big. So you can see me come in the church and have my nice clothes and my shining shoes in the foot. You know, when the sun hit it, you know, you can see a reflection in the shoes, and you know. If only the Spirit of God could dwell in material Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have I give. In the name of Jesus, get up and walk. Because you see, God dwells in the things of low degree so that he would be glorified. You know, if you have observed, when God chooses people, most times he chooses people that society looked down upon.
Amen.
What they call the scrum of society, they look at you and they say, you are good for nothing. And they say, you know, who are you? Your father was nobody. And you don't have a surname. And you know, your whole family, you know, they were from low estate. And you know you can come out nothing. You know you can achieve nothing in this life. But when God say yes, your man can say no. Paul was a man born of the due time. Because God had a purpose for him. He was on his way to destroy the people of God. But God arrested him. The Spirit of God arrest him.
Yeah.
And the Spirit of God has arrested us.
Yes.
And when the Spirit of God arrests us, sometimes we don't like it. But a charge to keep, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save, that I may fit it for the sky. You see, the Spirit is saying, do not say that you are too small. Do not say that you are too young. Do not say you are too poor. Do not say you are not anybody. Because God delighted not in those things. But God delighted in a clean heart, a clean hand, and a pure heart. For he said, a clean hand and a pure heart, he will not despise. So your house may not be a mansion. And you know, your vehicle may not be an, you know, a Honda CRV, or you may not be driving a Lamborghini, but you see, God delighteth not in those things. But he said, the cattle on a thousand hills are mine. The cattle on a thousand hills are mine. So there is no thing on earth that he could give to me that I do not already have. I do not want your material possession. I do not want your money. I do not want your clothes. I do not want your homes. I do not want your land. But I want your heart. Sons and daughters, give me your heart, and I will give you a kingdom. I do not want your possessions. I delight not in those things. David said, thou Lord delightest not in sacrifice, else I will give it. God wants our hearts. He said, sons and daughters, give me your hearts, and I the Lord will give you a kingdom. Seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and everything else shall be added unto you. So Paul said he was the least of the apostles. No, wherever you have a group of men, they like to establish hierarchy. They like to, you know, put men in ascending and descending on them. No, in order of significance. So they say, they look at this man there and they say that he's the most important man in the organization. Or they look at this man there and they say, that man, you know, don't worry him, what he say don't matter, because that's the least of all of us, you know. No, his word does not count, but that chain is no stronger than its weakest link. There is a story, anytime I'm speaking about topics like this, you know, there is a story I like to give. When I was in school, I can't remember if it's college or university, but because the teacher talking about touch, I taught them both of them. When I finished time to see, I said, thank God, I got what I said, but I was in SU, said, but I'd say, here I come. But Mr. Saint Bernard used to say, at the time he told us that story, he said, the different parts of the body was having an argument.
And when different parts of the body argue, they argue which one more important. So you know this talk about, you know, they say the brain more important than the heart. And another side would say the heart more important than the brain. No, but they say the in us. Say, if I should close what I have done me, I'm a morning problem. If I close, I'm a morning problem. So stay on the top and argue which one was significant. But if the man and the Lord ever should have withdrawn himself, the organization would be nothing.